fight of the century. Just 40, 50 years later, which most people know, Jack Johnson, born in Galveston, Texas. He was a bad man. He was a bad man. And just to fast forward a little bit, he had what they called the fight of the century, because now we're in the 19th century. In 1910, he fought the heavyweight champion Jim Jeffries. Jim Jeffries, and they said that was the fight of the century, and that's where this term, the White Hope, came up, because they knew that this Jim Jeffries couldn't beat Jack Johnson. Jack Johnson, the black man born in Galveston, Texas, I mean, he was just dusting people off, and because of racism back at that time, you weren't even allowed to fight anyone white. At that time, they had what they called the Colored Federation. Black people weren't even allowed to challenge for the heavyweight championship. They weren't allowed. Remember, you're talking about 1910, when lynchings, public lynchings, were still going on. But what happened was, Jack Johnson was so popular and he was beating up so many people, he actually beat Jim Jeffries' younger brother in a fight, and they hyped it up so much, and they offered, Jim Jeffries $65,000 to fight in 1910, which is equivalent to about $3.1 million today. And they offered Jack Johnson about maybe $40,000, which is equivalent about $2 million. So they said, we got to take this. So they fought in Reno, Nevada in 1910, and Jack Johnson beat the hell out of him and became technically the first black world heavyweight champion in 1910. And it was a lot of racial tension. After connecting this to Floyd Mayweather and this McGregor, it was so much racial tension before and after the fight. Do you know, after Jack Johnson beat him, riots broke out all over the United States? If you look up reports, some 250 people were killed in riots because Jack Johnson, the black man, beat this Jim Jeffries, the heavyweight champion. People were killed. New York, Chicago, St. Louis, there in Nevada, Philadelphia, all over the country, racial tension and riots broke out because a black man beat this white man, Jim Jeffries. Racial tension just all over the place. Riots. We can't have nothing. He beat him. After he won the championship in 1910, do you know Jack Johnson was not allowed to defend his title against against a black person? So their thinking was, if we ban black people from fighting Jack Johnson and only have white people fight him, we'll still have this white hope. So for 6 years after Jack Johnson won the title in 1910, he was not allowed to defend his title against another black fighter. And I have to be honest, I'm for the truth. I'm for black people, but I'm for the truth. Do you know Jack Johnson also agreed with that and said, I don't want to fight them anyway? Jack Johnson, the black man, said, I don't care that you're banning other black fighters from fighting me. I don't want to fight them anyway because it's a waste of my time. So for 6 years, Jack Johnson refused to fight other black fighters. He was a Negro, and he was also married to this white woman named Iris. That's why it was so much racial tension. He refused to fight other black fighters for 6 years. And it wasn't until another brother came along and they allowed him to fight, and then he lost the title in 1915. I forget the brother's name. Wasn't a brother, a white man actually beat him, but he finally fought a black person. It took almost 6 years for him to fight because it was illegal for him to defend the title against another black man. And then he fought actually until he was like almost 66 years old. And when he was 68, a small town not too far where I'm at now, I'm in Durham, North Carolina, a place called North Carolina, about 20 miles outside of Raleigh, somewhere around there. He was at a restaurant. Then he got a wake-up call. He got a wake-up call to what this country is really about. He went to a restaurant, and because he was married to this white woman and he had his own self-hate in him with his own black people, they refused to serve him at this restaurant. He was so pissed off that he got in his car and sped off, and he got into an accident, and he died in a car accident here in Franklin, North Carolina, in 1946. He died at the age of 68. That's Jack Johnson. That's how he died. Moving forward, more racial tension in boxing. Sugar Ray Leonard, Roberto Duran. Roberto Duran is Latino or Mexican or whatever. A lot of racial tension with that. Not to the point where it was causing riots. There was a lot of racial tension. If you go back into the early 80s with those two fighting. I work with Black and Latino students because I'm a counselor and a mentor in the school system. This is fast forward, then I'm going to rewind back. Just 2 years ago when Floyd Mayweather fought Manny Pacquiao. I like Manny Pacquiao. There was a lot of racial tension with that. I work with 10, 11, 12-year-olds, and you should have seen the racial hostility that was going on just with young people. We want him to beat that, and they wanted to say it, but they saw me. So even then, for Sugar Ray Leonard, Roberto Duran, a lot of racial tension. In 1982, they came back with this Great White Hope again with Jerry Cooney with my brother Larry Holmes. They called Jerry Cooney the Great White Hope because he beat Ken Norton pretty good. It was a lot of racial tension with that. My mother actually knows and is good friends with Larry Holmes' wife because Larry Holmes is from Eastern Pennsylvania, not too far where I grew up. When Larry Holmes won the title in 1978, me, my mom, and my dad was there, and I actually have a picture. I've showed it on Facebook. I was there in a press conference with him, and he took a picture with me with him in 78 when he won the title. But again, in 78, he beat Ken Norton for the title. And in 82, he went up against Jerry Cooney, an Irish man born in New York. A lot of racial tension. You know, they'd start vandalizing Larry Holmes' house and was threatening him over this fight. But of course, in 82, he ended up dusting off Jerry Cooney to retain his heavyweight title. But it was a lot of racial tension with that fight. So we see a pattern with boxing and racial tension in boxing. Now, here we have it. In 2017, and I've seen some people try to brush this off as, oh, they're just hyping up the fight. It's marketing. Yeah, I understand that. But to take it to this level, to say dance for me, boy, then they try to make an excuse saying, well, he's from Ireland. He don't know the racial tension. He knows. He knew exactly what he was saying, I'm half Black. I'm half Black from waist down. And come on, you Black women that may like me, I'll do this and that, making all these racial and racial insensitive remarks. Let me show you how these people think. Let me show you how this just isn't no marketing ploy. Anyone who has went to college, and especially anyone, and I'll be done after this, anyone who has went to college, and I appreciate those who have tuned in because you could be doing anything else, but you're listening to me. Anyone else who has went to college, and especially if you taken psychology or counseling classes, because my master's degree is in counseling, you had to do some prerequisite courses in psychology 101, and you had to study the teachings and the writings of Sigmund Freud. Give me an amen if you know what I'm talking about. You had to study the writings and teachings of Sigmund Freud, who is a world-renowned psychiatrist. A lot of the one-on-one, if anyone had to see a counselor, the one-on-one counseling that you get, Sigmund Freud invented that. It's called what you call psychotherapy. Psychotherapy. Sigmund Freud invented that. This is how I'm connecting it to, this isn't no coincidence with Conor McGregor, the racial epithets that he's set out. Listen to what Sigmund Freud said, even though I'm not no big fan of him because he said some other off-the-wall things. But listen, the most honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us. The most honorable Elijah Muhammad said, even if the devil tells the truth, give him credit for telling the truth. Sigmund Freud said, it is impossible for the human being to suppress his inner feelings, thoughts, ideas, concepts, and emotions. I'm going to say it again. Sigmund Freud said, it is impossible for the human being to suppress his inner feelings, thoughts, concepts, and emotions. He said it's impossible to suppress that. And he said the way that you get someone to reveal his inner thoughts, feelings, and emotions, he said, just get them to talking. He said, just get someone to talking, and pretty soon they will reveal their inner thoughts, feelings, and emotions, because it's impossible to suppress that.
It won't be the last time.